Sports, wine, life. This is the Macko and Cause podcast.
Hey, everyone, and welcome to the Macko and Cause podcast. It is currently 9:48 p.m. on Monday, May 31st. And Bob, the Wizards are looking to avoid the sweep. They're up 112-111 against Philly with 146 to go.
Can't wait for this Utah-Memphis match to start. I'm going to shut up for a bit because I want to hear your take. But I think right now, the best take I've heard is from your coworker, Brian Hayes, who just tweeted out one word, believable.
That it is.
So, Matt, what was your take?
It's funny, at this moment, and I feel bad for Jim Richards. I just did a hit with him. He was expecting drunken, frothy me. And he got a guy that was eating sliced peppers and hummus and drinking coffee. I did the angry show today. I did the angry show Friday. So right now, I'm in the, I'm not angry, I'm just disappointed, which of course is a fucking lie. And we've all heard it from our partners. We all have thrown that line out there. It ain't true, but I don't know. My anger-o-meter at the moment is low. Maybe it'll go up, but like Brian Hayes is right. It is totally believable. And my joke today was, we're all so dumb. We all got fooled. We all got roped in. And the thing is, super smart people were all there telling us everything was going to be different and okay. And we believed everyone, Bob.
So we should probably point out, although I suspect it's not that necessary, Leafs lose to the Habs in seven. Yep. Mm-hmm. They go down 3-1. Although really the one was cosmetic. William Nylander scored with about a buck 30 left, but it was, let's just call it mostly 3-0.
Yes. Exactly.
I got a theory about why, because I'm with you. I actually feel more subdued than angry. And when they lost to Boston the first time, 4-1 with the collapse, that was kind of shock. That feeling was shock. And then when they were up and blew it in game six and lost in game seven the following year, that one was angry. That one felt more like a collapse. Columbus, I was disappointed, but I thought it was weird. Like, they basically played one game after that long break, and then they had a tough matchup, and just, like, it wasn't a great five-game series, but I didn't know what to make of it. But I feel like I know exactly what to make of this. They're not that good.
When you look at Matthews and Marner, and listen, Nylander was very good in the series, but he didn't do anything tonight until that meaningless goal. How, like, now that we have the hindsight of what we saw last year and all of that, I now I'm confused. How do we view them? Maybe they aren't as great as we think, or as great as the team thinks they are, or as great as they think they are, because they certainly demanded to be paid by true difference makers. Bob, these are regular season guys who can't do it in the postseason. That's where they are right now.
There are so many questions, and it's going to be hard not to have them smush all together.
Yeah.
You know, we've done absolutely zero prep for the pod. We're calling each other within about 4 minutes of the game ending. So it's not like there's been a lot of time to think about this, but one of the reasons why the 4-1 collapse was so staggering is because it kind of came out of nowhere. Like, they had basically won, and then out of nowhere, it just all went away. But we watched this in slow motion over three games. That's why I think nobody's really stunned right now. Like, people are angry, they're disappointed. By the way, it's funny, my Leafs in six words from a couple days ago was, I am not mad, I'm disappointed. That was
hey,
we got that together. That was my reaction after game six. There hasn't been a lot of time to bring thoughts together, but pretty much everything that you thought could go wrong did. A key injury exposed that they didn't have as much depth as they needed. I'm not going to say everything that went wrong could go wrong did. That's not true. That's totally not true. I totally take that back.
What, Bob, fact, what's wrong is simple. Matthews and Marner didn't produce. They failed. I'm not saying right. They're failures as hockey players, but they failed. They failed in this round. They failed last year against Columbus. They failed against teams that the Leafs were clearly the better team. You know, I mean, it just, it simply comes down to that.
I was shocked watching Marner tonight. Mm-hmm. He wasn't even, I snarkily tweeted out the Invisible Man, a gif of the twist Invisible Man halfway through the game. By the third period, I was wishing he would only be invisible. He was like negative. He was impacting everything negatively. I can't remember a player that good playing this bad. Maybe John Starks, but Mitch Marner's a lot better than John Starks. And I'm going back to that old Knicks series and the famous 3-for-18 where he just kept shooting.
Yes, I'm aware.
This was just like a guy who literally forgot how to play hockey. He was awful. He wasn't even bad, Matt. He was awful. It's like he was wearing a Habs jersey. He couldn't do anything.
You saw it at the end of the first period with a couple of seconds left. He had a good chance. Can't score, and you can see how miserable he was. And then the Brendan Gallagher goal, that was a Marner turnover. He looked miserable. He had a chance a little bit after that where Hyman's got a good chance, and it was a great pass by Marner, but Price was there with another great save. But you're right. You also saw Marner like fumbling the puck as the Leafs were trying to establish the cycle. He looked lost. He looked rattled. He looked like a guy who knew that a lot of this was going to be on him. And he failed. He failed. Matthews failed. Matthews, Marner, and Nylander had one shot after two periods. This after they didn't show up in the first period in game five and game six. It happened again. To quote Brian Hayes, believable.
He really does have the primo take so far. I don't know what happened to Austin Matthews, because at least through the first few games, like, he didn't score, but he was quite energized and he was throwing his body around. And you know, in game two, he looked really good. And so it's not like it was a total no-show. What happened was, when it was time to close out, and we all know that game five can be hard because, you know, you're playing a desperate team and, you know, it's almost like the series version of score effects. You have a pretty good sense you're going to win. Statistically, you know, the team that's favored going into a series, I think, has something like a 94% winning percentage in all American sports, went up 3-1 in a game seven. So statistically, it's almost impossible to blow it. You could understand how game five could be a little bit of a flat tire. But I don't know. It was weird. It was like the more intense the series got, the less he showed up. And
that's it right there. That's it right there. Yes, Bob, you nailed it.
Yeah. You know, Matt, I will say this. I don't want to take any of the credit away from Montreal, who played really well. Like, and I'm not even sure they played really well. They just played really hard. They played really hard, and they got good goaltending and just enough scoring. You know, they never blew the Leafs out. What they really did was they made the Leafs look docile. You know, like, they never, there were times when the Leafs lost to Columbus that it looked like they just couldn't play hockey, and that happened again. It's not like they lost to a superior team. They just got knocked around by a more physical team, and a team that, it's such a cliche, but how else do you put it? They wanted it more.
They did. Oh, yeah. Corey Perry, always there. Always there. The young guys, no fear. And Carey Price being Carey Price. That's what did it. Marner had fear. Matthews, fear. Like, those guys, you know, they played too safe. When you're playing that safe early on, that says to me fear. And that's what we saw tonight.
Through one, the first period was pretty boring.
Yeah,
I actually thought this could go, well, obviously one of two ways, but I really wasn't sure. It felt like this game's really boring, but the Leafs only need about a good 5 minutes for the blue wave to come out and score a quick two, maybe even three, in 5 to 8 minutes and put this thing away. Because it's been a snooze fest so far, but it's almost like a sports car that's just like, you know, waiting for the light to turn.
Yeah.
And then the other side was, the longer this goes and the longer it's close and the longer it's sleepy, the better it is for the Habs, because the Leafs can out explosive you, but the Habs couldn't do that. They just had to keep it close and hope that they got that first Campbell goal sucked, right? Like, let's be serious.
That was on Campbell. That was bad by him as well. Yes.
Yeah, that sucked. And he probably won't get the blame he deserves for that, because he let in a real stinker of a goal in a game seven. And, you know, it doesn't feel like that sunk the team, though. There was more than enough time to come back from it. I don't know, Matt. Now I'm starting to, like, I don't want to ramble. Let's try to be focused here. And I'm speaking mostly to myself here.
Well, listen, I can be more focused because A, not only did I make notes, but B, you would appreciate this. Early in the third period, I started to write my opening thought as if the Leafs lost because I wanted to try to reverse jinx it so all my hard work would be thrown out. Like, yeah. I literally do that. I went through all the UFAs, all the RFAs. I've already written my opening thought, and I did it hoping I could reverse jinx it, but I couldn't.
All right, so preview it here. Let's hear it.
Well, you already heard the first part, which is the I'm starting with I can't do the angry show today. I did that on Friday and Monday because I'm officially in the I'm not angry, I'm just disappointed phase. So I do a bit of that. And then, you know, I bring up, like, listen, there's lots of other Hall of Famers who had to wait far longer to win a Stanley Cup than Matthews, Marner, Nylander, Mario Lemieux, Ovechkin, Yzerman, Connor McDavid. But there's one difference. All those guys, including Connor McDavid, they have at least a playoff series win. Like, McDavid has a playoff series win. Ovechkin had six before he won a cup. But those teams won three President's Trophies. Yzerman had to wait 14 years, but he had 10 playoff series wins and even made a cup finals. You know, this team, it's you can't compare it to, like, the weight that Ovechkin had to go through, because those teams at least kicked ass in the regular season. And then at some points they advanced in the playoffs.
You make such a great point, and it's so beautifully laid out, Matt. This is not just, everybody's going to say, you got to be patient. And this is just a talented series of players who are just trying to find their way. And sometimes it happens quicker than others. And this is pretty slow, but this feels different somehow, doesn't it? Like it.
Oh yeah.
Like, just the amount of first round disappointment. Did anyone else go out in the round four times in a row in the first round? I can't think of
any. Not that I can't think of any. I didn't realize until I looked it up that Lemieux, his team didn't even make the playoffs for the first 4 years. But in the fifth year,
they first overall, right? Like, they sucked so bad when they got him. They had a lot to rebuild. Geez. Okay, so where do we go from here? Because, I mean, we got to do some blame game, don't we?
Well, I mean, the problem is the guys you blame, you can't move. You're not moving Matthews and Marner. We're not blaming Kyle Dubas. We're not blaming Sheldon Keefe. Let's face it, Bob. We all know how this works. You know, Paul McFarland, Jim Hiller, DJ Smith, Andrew Brewer. We know how this goes. Manny Malhotra's getting fired. Guy runs the power play. If there's a pound of flesh to be given, I say you fire him. And I tweeted this out, so it's not like I just thought of this off the top of my head. Hire Haley Wickenheiser. As I tweeted out, this is far more important for humanity to fix the power play than her being a doctor. Bring her in to run the power play. She's already part of the Leafs organization.
Those are all very compelling thoughts. The Haley Wickenheiser is a nice touch, actually. I like that.
Thank
you.
You
know, people, you know, as our dear friend Jeff Merrick likes to say, you know, local sports is like an angry volcano. Sometimes you just have to feed it a sacrifice.
Yep.
And I honestly don't know who it would be. Clearly, of your big four, you're not getting rid of anybody.
Nope.
There's going to be a lot of turnover anyway because of contracts, UFA and RFA. But mm-hmm. I don't think anybody feels that satisfactory because the problem wasn't the team around them. The problem was, no. Well, your fourth of the big four got hurt. You know, that's not his fault. But of the other three, well, Nylander was great for most of the series. You can't blame him.
Nope, Nylander was great until tonight.
You know, that top line, God, they were so bad in this game. And Marner was. So here, let me throw this out to you.
Yeah.
During the contract negotiations, the organization, well, I guess really Marner, let's say they didn't really protect each other from the bad press. And the fans chose the Leafs in this case. You know, they didn't like Marner. And that, I think, probably surprised his camp. I think they thought people would see him as the golden boy and it would go kind of like the Nylander one did. But it didn't. They blamed him for being greedy, too. And he didn't take it well. And if you talk to people around the team, whether covering or on the team, like, everybody seems to say that kind of spun him out for the year. It took him a lot of time to sort of get his bearings back after being not popular with the fans. And this could get bad. And I wonder, does he have the appetite to come back for this? Or behind the scenes, if, like, they start going on social media and seeing his name trending all the time with "you suck," is he the kind of player who's going to want to fight his way through it to prove everybody wrong? Or is he just going to want to go to where the waters aren't so choppy?
That's going to be the question. It's a great question, Bob. No, I have no answer. If no. I'm them, yeah, I turn off all social media. I spend 2 weeks, I'd say fly somewhere, but it's Ontario. You can't go anywhere. Find yourself a cottage, go kayaking, and, you know, and just stay away from the world for a week or two.
I don't think there's anything, you know, I was listening to the 31 Thoughts pod with Merrick and Friedman this morning, and they were talking about how Columbus might be looking at turning over their roster because, you know, Seth Jones is all but gone, and, you know, they just got a lot of, there's a lot of turnover there potentially. And maybe they're looking at doing a total rebuild. And they brought up the point about Zach Werenski and, you know, would he want to stay with the team long term? And then you start thinking, okay, something crazy NBA-ish has to happen eventually in the NHL where two superstars get flipped for each other. I suppose you could say Dubois and Laine, but I don't think they're big enough just yet. I don't know. Like, can we envision at least without Marner on it?
I don't think so. I'm not 100%. I'm at a point where the door is at least open where, put it this way, up until like game six, I would have said that's stupid. I would have said 100%. Now I can't. Now I'm like, no, 98% chance he comes back. If you look at roster turnover, Freddie Anderson, I say you let him go. You got Jack Campbell next year at $1.625 million. Again, Bob, this is what I did in the third period. I was on Cap Geek. I was researching Mary Lou Mew and Steve Yzerman. All of it in attempt to reverse jinx the Leafs. It did not happen. But the money you save on Freddie, maybe you use it on Hyman. Eventually an extension for Morgan Riley. Maybe use it. I don't know. Maybe use it on another scoring winger.
Like, you've got to change up this team. I don't feel like Riley's back.
Well, Riley's got another year at $5 million. And Morgan Riley, he was...
I think they're going to trade him.
He was good in the playoffs. He was really good.
Yeah, but that just makes his trade value higher. You got to do something, Matt. You can't...
True. No, you're right. You're right. You're right, Bob.
With this team, and he's got a year, and people... I'm sure you can get something decent back for him. I've been saying this all year, that you shouldn't hang on to that too long, that contract, and just let him get away for nothing. Or overpay him when his time comes around. I don't know, but it feels like after this collapse, and it is a collapse, that somebody's got to get thrown into the volcano, as Jeffy says. And I think it's Riley. I think Riley's going to go. You got to get rid of somebody.
Yeah.
You know, you can't. Well, let me ask you.
No, you're right. You're right.
Can you march this team back next year and get excited about it, even if they succeed?
No. No, you have to make a change. But I'm saying you'd save a bunch of money with Jack Campbell as your starter at that little amount. So yeah, then sure. you've got stuff to play with. You can go bring in someone else.
Let me ask you, like, here's the hierarchy. So people are really mad at the players right now, particularly the stars, and they should be. Not Nylander, but, you know, Matthews Marner. That's who we really mean. Yep. Nobody's really talking about Keith, except for some people, like, why has the power play been so bad? But it feels like... he's in a kind of a protected cove right now. And then Dubas is always on the hot seat. So let's talk about Dubas for a second. This is on the players. Did he get Keith the wrong players?
I mean, at this moment at 10:08 p.m., you would say yes. But could anyone have predicted the complete disappearing act of Matthews and Marner? Because that's what this comes down to. Campbell overall was great. That was a great deal. For Kyle Dubas. Jake Muzzin has been one of their best defensemen. TJ Brody's been great. All of those was Kyle Dubas. I view this as the players, not the GM. You saw the hesitancy on the power play, their inability to establish the rush and establish position. Marner, you know, just fiddling around all over the place. So I'm good with Dubas. In fact, the one thing I don't want to hear, but I know we will, is Dubas is going to go full Jack Campbell when he blamed himself for getting scored on that two-on-0 goal in game six. I don't want Kyle Dubas to say it's on me. I don't want him to do that. I say, no, I did my job. They didn't do theirs.
This is the best Leafs team in a long time. And in that regard, absolutely. And I'm inclined to say that Dubas is not the primary cause why this happened. I don't think that's the case. However, let me play devil's avocado here for a second.
Sure.
You brought in Simmons and Thornton. They both gave you nothing.
Yep.
You signed Mikheyev to a 2-year deal. Is that what they got him on?
He was shit.
Yep. He was shit. You know, Spets has been very nice, but your big move was for Foligno. He brought nothing. I know he got kind of banged up, but so be it. Riley Nash played a little bit of one game, wasn't there, didn't happen. You know, there were a lot of things that were used to bolster the lineup, quote unquote. They didn't work. But the defense looks a lot better. I absolutely grant you that. And look, I'm not trying to criticize Dubas myself. I think he did a good job. However, there is one thing that I have to question here. There was the idea that, hey, we're good enough that we don't need to strengthen our, you know, we don't need more talent. We need more character. Well, they didn't have enough talent and the character shit the bed. So maybe that was a miscalculation that you can hold someone accountable for. The talent was out there.
Well, that's just about Taylor Hall. I mean, this is all just
a small thing. You could have added a Hart Trophy winner to your team for a second round pick, and you chose to go for Nick Foligno, who added basically a fight in the first game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, Foligno was good when in the regular season, then didn't do much, was banged up. I don't know how bad his groin was. I also don't know, like, did Hall want to come there? Like, I need to know the full story of Taylor Hall going to Boston. Was there a chance he was going to come to Toronto, or did he, after, you know, time spent in Edmonton, is like, nope, I'm not going back to Canada.
Yeah, maybe that's entirely true. And I don't know. I can't blame him for not getting him. Although the idea that somehow the Leafs were good enough and they just needed a little bit more character was maybe wrong. And when they're looking at going into next year, maybe it's not we just need more double extra character. Maybe they need some more talent.
Well, maybe, but again, all roads lead back to Matthews and Marner. If those guys are 80% of who they were in the regular season, the Leafs win this series. It doesn't go seven.
You know what?
All roads lead back there.
I'm not going to disagree with you. That's obviously true. However, when Tavares went down, they were pretty thin down the middle, bud. Like,
how many teams out there can lose a guy like Tavares and not be thin down the middle?
No, I don't know. Tampa Bay lost Stamkos.
And they hit Point. And they, by the way, Point, Kucherov, Hedman, and Vasilevskiy. Those guys, you know, all acted like stars. Point and Kucherov acted like stars. Matthews and Marner didn't.
Well, I'm not going to disagree with you with that regard, but you know, the four guys that you listed off there are all better than everybody the Leafs have.
Yeah.
You know, like everybody was like, oh, Marner's so amazing. Well, you know, Braden Point was up, you know, his RFA year was the same year as I recall. And, you know, there were a lot of people behind the scenes saying, I think I'd much rather have Point than Marner, you know, Kucherov.
And Bob, you know what that all goes to then?
Hmm.
This, if you want to trace it back, like the Leafs didn't do more at the deadline. Well, you know how you can, and I'm sorry to be a broken record, but I'm going to continue to be. This goes back to the negotiations for Matthews and Marner. This goes back to the amount of money those guys demanded. They're getting paid more than anyone on Tampa. They're getting paid more than anyone on Chicago or a lot of these other teams. And because they got all that money, it limited what Dubas can do. So much of this you can trace back to they paid those guys $22 million. They played them 24 minutes a night, and those guys did nothing.
Yeah, it's 100% true. And you say broken record, but the fact is, if we want to move on from what just happened to what happens now, what you just mentioned is the most important thing, because that determines how much you can actually do, both with those two guys and also around them. You know, the Tavares deal, Jesus, I mean, that's just, I'm not going to disparage a guy, obviously, who's hurt and, you know, you just hope he's okay. But, man, that's a big question mark going into next year is, like, is he even playing next year? Who knows?
Well, he was on the ice. I think if they played Winnipeg, he would have been with the team at some point against Winnipeg.
You know, I tend to think that that's probably true, but I think also neither of us know, because whenever you have an injury like this, if it's as bad as it like, who knows, Matt? Who knows? Let's just say, at the very least, there's a Tavares question mark because he's older and he's coming off a serious head injury.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, so who knows which player you get back next year? Hopefully, it's the guy we saw at the end of this year. That would be amazing if he picked up where he just left off. That may not happen. We'll find out. Fuck, what do you do with Marner? What do you do with Matthews? Like, I don't even know how to talk about this team right now. Because last year I was the guy who was like, let's not panic. It was a bad loss, but it's still growing pains. Like, how long do growing pains last before you say they're not the right fucking guys?
They had those questions in Washington. But again, the difference, those teams won in the playoffs. Those teams won President's trophies. So, Bob, here's another hearty dose of I don't know. Remember 2 years ago against Boston, game one, Toronto wins like 4-1. Marner's got two goals, and he blocks a shot with his face late in the game. He hasn't scored a goal since.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's a strange player to figure out. I mean, he's so good. And really, like, there's so much enthusiasm to his game. It's not even just that he's talented. It's like he brings a lot of creativity and energy, and he energizes people around him. And, you know, in the playoffs, there's just something that happens. And he was so bad tonight, Matt. It wasn't even like snake bit. Like, you could make the argument that Austin Matthews was snake bit. You know, he had like a 3% shooting percentage. And, you know, you're going up against Carey Price, and he did this to the Pens last year. And, you know, you can make all kinds of things like a goal scorer. That's just the way it goes sometimes. The puck just doesn't go in for you. But Matthews looked like he forgot how to play hockey.
Marner, you mean? Yes.
I'm
yes.
Sorry, Marner. Like, even just all the stupid puck over glasses that we started to laugh about because they were so ridiculous. It was like everything that a guy could do to keep his composure, he didn't.
Mm-hmm. He lost his composure. Absolutely, he did. You know, fixable? Montreal broke his brain. What's that?
Is that fixable?
Well, if you want to say yes, you'd point to the fact I think he's 23, and you could say that obviously it can be fixable, but I don't know. Honestly, you know, at this point, now there's going to be Marner for Jack Eichel trade talks. That, like, things like that are going to come up.
You know, it's. I give Merrick really a lot of. I listened to that 31 questions pod, and they did a really good job of talking to Steve Dangle. And Merrick asked him a good question, which is who's the one who's going to wear this? Who's going to have the ire if they lose? You know, because Toronto historically has always had like one player that they just really drill down on, whether it was Jake Gardner or Larry Murphy or whatever, and it's always been a defenseman, as they pointed out. And I thought that Steve brought up a good point, which was people are prepared to not like Marner. Like, there's just something about that contract negotiation that kept everybody, like, it just left such a bad taste in so many people's mouths. And, like, this is the worst playoff series you could have had if you were that guy. Because not only did you not perform, you got outworked, out-hustled, out-maneuvered. And it makes me wonder, like, maybe this kid has a great career ahead of him, but maybe it's not here.
We're getting closer to that. We're absolutely getting closer to that. And yeah, there was always a dark cloud on that contract negotiation. And so Marner's the guy who's going to wear it. But the next one's got to be Matthews. Like, Austin Matthews, is him and Marner, are they like a slightly higher end version of DeMar DeRozan? You know, wonderful scoring in the regular season. But then come the playoffs, neither one of them, you know, they would have some good moments, but then they would shrink. Matthews has 24 points in 32 playoff games. Those are good numbers, but those are not good numbers for a guy who gets the minutes, the time on the power play, and the amount of money. 13 goals in 32 games. You know, we could talk about snake bit and shooting percentage and goalies. I don't care. You just got to find a way to score. You just have to do it. He didn't.
Well, I'm going to throw something out here, Matt. When we look at the history of, like, those number one centers who have really excelled, it's not just that they have terrific lines around them, but that second line is usually pretty damn good, you know, and mm-hmm. whether it's Jonathan Toews, who was taking a run at the world's best player for a while, but he had Kane and Sharp and Hossa and Seabrook and Keith, and those were amazing teams. Like, they weren't good. They were amazing. And you think about Kopitar, but then you look at those teams, whether it was, you know, Doughty and Carter, and you just, like, they were stacked. like, maybe if we're honest with ourselves, the Leafs are good, but not great. And we kind of lost
that. That's true.
They were in the North, and the North was not was good, but not great. And I realized that Montreal won, but Montreal won a classic hockey underdog series. Get good goaltending, throw the other team's stars off their game, and get some bounces. I'm not disparaging what they did, but if they played that series 100 times over on paper through a computer simulation, the Leafs would win it, I don't know what, 70 times?
Yeah.
But hockey's not a computer simulation.
Sure, good if it was.
And we'd be on our way to, Winnipeg would be on a plane on their way here right now.
Mm-hmm. They would be.
Yeah. What I'm trying to say after that long filibuster is whatever concoction of personalities they have on this team, they don't work. And it's a big gamble when you have assets to say, but, you know, I'm sure one day they might. And maybe you're not desperate to make a move, but maybe in your heart, you kind of know that you have to because you're just not good enough yet.
And the problem is all the teams above them, all their star players are making less money than Matthews and Marner.
Jesus, I mean, it really does look like, particularly that Marner deal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I refuse to disparage Matthews for his regular season or even moving forward. I feel like on game one coming back, he could score a hat trick and everyone would love him again. I'm not so sure that's true of Mitch.
The big bummer of all of this, Bob, is next year, Toronto could go 20-0 to start the year. And Marner could learn how to fly. And Matthews could cure polio. And we're going to cross our arms, rightfully so, and say, yeah, we'll do it in the playoffs.
Fuck, this was a really likable Leafs team, too. You know,
it was.
There's just so many guys to really enjoy, like Joe Thornton and Wayne Simmonds and Spezza. You know, they just like had this kind of vintage character about them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It's going to be really like now the fog is starting to set in for me. We sit back and go, how the hell am I supposed to feel about the next 5 months? It's not even a bad
thing. 5 months. 11 months.
Yeah, you're right.
A year. Like, I'm going to have to do this for a year.
If somebody had to go, who is it? If somebody had to go.
Okay, if it's between Matthews, Marner. I mean, we're talking about Matthews, Marner, and Nylander, right?
Or it could be in the front office. Or it could be a coach. Yeah. But it has Manny Malhotra.
Yeah.
Be like,
yeah, like assistant coaches, who cares? They right. come and go. So it's not assistant coaches. Like, if we're really doing this, I get the idea of, you know, maybe you get rid of Morgan, you trade Morgan Riley, and you don't bring back Freddie Anderson. If you do that, now you've got lots of money to spend, and you hope that Sandin, who was, listen, he was shaky. After being good, and he was either game two or three, he was shaky tonight. But you hope that Sandin can grow, and you bring back Bogosian, and maybe hope Liljegren, you know. But and then you go and you bring in some high end talent. You know, the money that you would save, you could bring in some high end talent. So that's one path. The other is the atomic option. You move Marner.
It's funny, you went with all players. I still feel like it's Dubas who would get fired.
Yeah, but no, I think Dubas is good for outweighs his bad. Like, what's the biggest sin is that the biggest sin is the Maple Leafs aren't Tampa.
No, their biggest sin is that they've lost in the first round 4 years in a row. And,
mm-hmm. yep,
and you know, like this is a team that has a long, like, eventually you start to become Bruce Boudreau, where you're like, oh man. You could never fire that guy. But how many game sevens do we have to lose?
Yeah.
You know, at some point, you know, I'm not saying I would do this. I personally wouldn't. But let's see when we wake up tomorrow what the hornet's nest is going to be like. They may find that it's just untenable to bring everybody back. And that something like we're not re-signing Freddie Anderson just ain't going to cut it. Because this wasn't even just a bad loss, Matt. Like, this is historic. Oh, how many fucking times does this team have to make history with their losses?
They can't, and they made real history.
They can't just lose. They have to, like, faceplant after slipping on a banana peel underneath of a ladder. Like, their losses are spectacular.
Bob, this is not a hyperbole. This is the greatest choke job in the history of Toronto sports. The number one champion was the 1985 Toronto Blue Jays.
That's got to be the biggest one, doesn't it?
No, it's not, because guess what? Kansas City won the World Series. Yes. Toronto just lost to a team that was ranked 18th in the NHL.
That's a really good point. You know, I think you should include that in your thought for tomorrow. I like that. That's when you go through something like this, there's a tendency to hyperbolize or to diminish what it is and not to actually look at what it really is, like to see it clear-eyed. But you're right, the way you put it, clear-eyed, this is the worst, certainly in our lifetime, the worst playoff loss of our lives.
Dave Steep, George Bell, pop the champagne. You're off the list.
Oh, man. Well, that sucks. to quote the great David St. Hubbins from Spinal Tap, too much fucking perspective.
Oh, shit. This is like, do you know how hard it's going to be if, you know, whatever they do in the regular season, like, unless they really change things up, if they bring back most of this team, the regular season is going to mean so little, so very, very little.
You know, my we should get going just because I got to go to bed. But my final thought on this is, ordinarily, I would blame hockey to say it kind of sucks. Like, I love in basketball how the better team almost always wins. And in hockey, that never seems to be the case. But in this one instance, I'm actually going to defend the Habs and what they did, because they had no business winning that series. Not with that team, not with the team that the Leafs had. But there really is something to be said about hockey that sometimes if you just work hard enough, you get it.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, we can think all we want about, you know, this strategy or this particular advanced stat that goes, you know, unappreciated. In the end, though, if it was so easy, like if you won based on the team that you had on paper, gambling would be way easier. You just can't quantify when you get to the playoffs who's just going to push for it that little bit harder, you know, and win those puck battles. And as much as I hate it for the Leafs, I kind of admire it about the game of hockey right now, that a bunch of guys with no business winning just did because they beat the shit out of someone bigger and stronger. And that's kind of cool for them.
It really is. You're right, Bob. It's a great summation. Before we end it, if anyone is thinking of suing the Maple Leafs, I don't think you'll win. But if you need a lawyer to try to do it, maybe try our lawyer, Jeff Pollock, at jeffpollock.com. That's Jeff with the G, the sponsor of this podcast, 416-777-0088, 416-777-0088. If you need help with litigation, states, trusts, your will, or you want to sue Manny Malhotra, may I recommend Jeff Pollock? Goodbye, Bob.
Wait. No, I know it was a good lie, but I just got one more. Don't sue Mitch Marner, though, because he's got the money to tie it up in court.
Ah, great line by you, Bob. Well worth it. See ya.
Thanks for listening to the Macko and Cause podcast. Remember to subscribe on iTunes or Audioboom. And if you like the podcast, leave a review. If you don't like the podcast, then maybe don't leave a review.